All right, welcome to the Lovecraft eZine podcast, videocast. Today is May the 8th, 2016. No guest today, as we sometimes do. We're just going to chat about a variety of topics. Let's have everybody introduce themselves for the podcast listeners. Joe, let's start with you. Work our way over.
Joe Pulver, writer and editor.
Kelly.
I'm Kelly Young. I'm the executive editor of Strange Eons magazine.
Matt.
I'm Matt Carpenter. I facilitate pretty much everyone else.
That's so true. It's more true than you realize. Pete.
Pete Rolick, writer of various things and editor of Legacy of the Reanimator.
And Rick.
Rick Lay, writer of Pulp Fiction.
You all thought
and Salome.
Tarantino.
Salome Jones, senior editor at Mistwood Books, editor most recently of Cthulhu Lies Dreaming, 23 Tales of the Weird and Cosmic.
Awesome book, you know. You should pick that up, folks. And, Rick, I love that movie, so great job on that. Pulp Fiction. All right, so let's begin with Pete Rolick.
What? What'd I do? What?
You have a cover for Animatrix, Reanimatrix
oh,
now.
Yeah, I have a cover
and
for you.
So I want you to tell people about it since the podcast listeners and the video listeners can't see unless you've got a physical copy of it. So. Which you probably don't yet. Oh, hang on. Let me put you on the big screen.
Let's put it on the big screen.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. That's amazing.
It's great.
I can see it. Open it up again.
It's a...
You can click on Pete in the bottom there, and he'll be big on your screen.
Woman and a man armed and ready to battle some octopus. Octopi.
Yep.
And... Describe this, Pete, for the podcast listeners, because it has kind of a, what would you say, a pulp aspect to
well,
it.
Yeah, so...
nostalgic aspect to it, maybe.
The inspiration for this novel is a... There's a great movie and an even better book by Vera Casprey called Laura, which is about it's a noir film. It's about a detective who picks up a murder case, and moves into this woman's house to try and solve her murder. And then she comes back because it's not her body that's dead. But in the meanwhile, he's fallen in love with her, at least with the idea of her, which then leads to some difficulties with her, you know, being alive and him living in her house. I really love the book, and I love the movie. And I decided that the basic premise was really, really good, but it would have been even better if it was set in Arkham. Because, you know, when you're dead in Arkham, it's really not dead.
Right. You can reanimate.
Exactly. So there's... I've been playing with these characters, if you've been reading my stories for a while. Robert Peasley is the son of Professor Peasley from The Shadow Out of Time. He's a survivor of World War I, a little bit of a hardened guy. He had some adventures while he was in Paris, and he has made his way back to Massachusetts, where he's assigned to Massachusetts Department X, and unwillingly he's sent to Arkham, where he handles all the crap that the local cops just don't want to deal with. The other character is Megan Halsey, who is the daughter of Alan Halsey from the very first or second chapter of Reanimator. And she is on a typical quest, not a father quest, but a mother quest. She's trying to find her mother. And her mother does not want to be found. And she ends up dead. And he picks up the case. and it all goes down.
Who did that cover?
Renee Agnier, I think is how you say his name.
I don't know. I copied and pasted it I pasted it yesterday, but.
When I'm working on stuff like this, I usually scroll through DeviantArt, and I found a whole bunch of works that he did.
Mean the website?
That's it.
Yeah, the website, not
DeviantArt.com.
Not DeviantArt per se.
He does that too. I hear you.
I found an image he had of a noir image with a woman in a kind of 30s outfit with guns. She had a pentacle as a belt buckle. And I think the title of the piece was called Film Noir. And, I put that up on the board in front of me, and I used that as inspiration. So when they asked me if I had any ideas for the artists, I said, well, this is what I've been using for inspiration. And I thought maybe they would just grab that new piece. And it's great. It's fabulous. We went through a lot of different layouts. I love this old retro kind of pulp feel to it within the pre stressing. It's pre-damaged for your enjoyment. And, it has that whole vintage Dell look to it. We put a whole bunch of lurid things together. I think the safest thing we could use was "He Could Only Love a Dead Woman." There were other things that I had decided that we wanted to use. And they're like, no, we can't do that. Like...
Oh, that's censorship, man.
Yeah.
I would refuse to publish with them. That's what I would do. It's a hell of a cover. And for those who are listening that do not know, this is the third in a series.
Right.
The first one being Reanimators.
Right.
And the second one, Weird Company. And then this one coming out in October is Reanimatrix.
Right.
And I believe, it has an Amazon link, so I think you can pre-order it. I can't remember for sure.
It's pre-order. Okay. I think the delivery date is October 4th. I will admit to just finishing rewrites on and delivering them on Friday. So, kind of tight. But doable. Not a problem to get a book out by October.
Especially if everything else is pretty much done. A couple of corrections and rewrites.
Yep. Well.
Oh, before I forget. Yeah.
So there's this thing where there's two of the chapters that are heavily graphic. And I've submitted a toned down version of both chapters. Just in case. And we'll see which one the publisher wants to go with. I like the way they're written, but it might be hard to market them to the younger crowd. So
there you have it. You can read a Lovecraftian novel with sex and violence in it coming out this October.
Or not.
See if it's the X-rated version or the R-rated version that makes it to the printer. Before I forget, Matt just got kicked out for some unknown reason because Google Hangouts moody, so hopefully he comes back. But him being kicked out, he usually reminds me of prizes. Dennis Wheeler with Fedogen and Bremer wants to give away two deluxe re-releases of the Fungi from Yagoth CD sets. So we'll use those for prizes today.
Nice.
And so thanks, Dennis. And Fedogen Bremer, if you're looking for a Lovecraftian book, their books are really great. Just Google Fedogen and Bremer. Kind of how it sounds, really. And look at their catalog. So All right, so...
Oh, I have to say this. The cover that Matt posted...
Yeah.
Nobody knows where that came from.
What does that mean?
Oh, the one from a couple of weeks ago?
Yeah. So, this is a, yeah, this is a draft cover. I didn't even get to see this cover before it hit the web. And nobody knows how this cover left the building and was got onto the street.
I forget the website where it ended up at, but they didn't tell you either?
No.
They refused or they didn't know?
No, they just didn't respond.
Yeah, so, it's easy way out.
You know, I hadn't even seen that cover before it hit the web. So somebody either got hacked or somebody let it out the back door and nobody's owning up to it. It doesn't matter. The cover's the same. The layout's a little bit different. That's all. But, yeah, the new cover, I like the new cover a lot more.
Could it be that you secretly released that to build controversy around the book? It could be.
That could be, except I have really good email documentation of somebody else sending me the cover and saying, I really like this cover. And I'm like, where the fuck did you get this? I haven't even seen it before.
You know, when Pete Rollick tells me that he went and scoured DeviantArt, then printed out a picture that he taped to the wall in front of him and uses air quotes and calls it inspiration, I have a completely different thought going through my mind.
Wow. Wow. You know, I can see
okay, well, on that note.
You know, Pete, when you raised the Laura point,
yeah,
the story that's been adopted for various TV shows, like Magnum P.I. did a variation of it, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, I wonder if the inspiration for that originally came from horror fiction.
That's a good question. But it's also the inspiration for one of my favorite television series. Twin Peaks.
Oh, yeah.
Who Killed Laura Palmer is inspired by... You know, Dale Cooper falls in love with Laura Palmer.
Right.
But she's dead. And, you know, the name... A lot of the little details in that series are drawn from Laura, the film or the book.
What I'm thinking is how many, I don't know where the idea originated, horror stories have you seen where, like, somebody sees a painting of a woman who lived long ago,
right,
loves an obsession for her, and then she turns out to be either a ghost or a vampire?
Yes.
Yep. Well, that didn't happen somewhere in time.
There's probably some gothic story that started all this.
That did not happen in somewhere in time, though. I have to interject that. She was actually dead, so he broke the time barrier and went back. All right, I'm the only one here who's seen somewhere in time. Okay,
seen somewhere in time. I've just kind of blotted it out from my memory.
Is that one about H.G. Wells and Jack the Ripper?
No.
No, that's Time After Time
or something like that.
That's a good movie.
That movie was Christopher and James Seymour.
Yes.
I think there's an earlier film with a similar plot called A Portrait of Jenny.
Ooh.
That Somewhere in Time is based on the Matheson story, which is spectacular.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
I haven't seen A Portrait of Jenny. I just know of it from Trailers from Hell on YouTube. they actually do movies that aren't horror fiction in Trailers from Hell, but I seem to remember they didn't go into the plot, but they said it's like Somewhere in Time.
All right. So the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival was last weekend, and in California, San Pedro, and Pedro, I don't know which one it is. And there's another one coming up in October in Portland, Oregon. So I think you can already buy your tickets for the one in Portland. Peter, you going to that one?
I am planning on going to that one. I haven't, like, confirmed it yet, but I think I'm going.
I think Young's going. It's a bit of a drive for him, but he's going.
I'll be there.
Right?
Yeah. I'm in Seattle.
Yeah, so. Yeah, that's like about a half
so
hour.
So anyway... Yeah, I know. That's one of those, it's one of those, is Mike joking or is he just being an idiot moments? Anyway, I had a great time at the film festival last weekend. It was nice of Cody and Aaron and James to invite me. I would have to say the highlight of the convention for me was probably just despite all the great programming, just hanging out with everybody. So, you know, there were some great films shown, and there was a panel on cosmic horror led by a spectacular moderator who seemed a little out of it that day. But
had spectacular panelists, too.
Yes, them, too. Yeah. Yeah, whatever.
That moderator asked.
Am I kidding? It was very spectacular. I did ask excellent questions, and a genius. I could go so far as genius questions. Nice. And I can say that, because I was feeling poorly due to constant issues that I have. And really out of it. So I said to Kelly, I said, I don't know what the hell I'm even going to ask. So Kelly came up with some questions and said, ask this. So the first one of those, the very simple, so let's define cosmic horror. What is cosmic horror? And they spent 30 minutes on that. So it was a great question. And yes, very excellent panelists. You're really great panelists, and all kidding aside. The other highlight for me was Torin Atkinson, I believe his last name, from Darkest of the Hillside Thickets, the band. He read, at the beginning of the readings, before the Cosmic Horror panel, he read The Statement of Randolph Carter. Joe, I think you're in the room for that. Kelly, I don't know if you were in the room yet then, or if you were, Matt, but it was spectacular, because he read it in the voices of... I can't remember, but one of the voices was Chris. Sorry?
Was James Mason one?
Yeah, that's right. James Mason, and I didn't hear him say that he was going to read the other character in the voice of Christopher Walken. So it was a complete surprise, and it was dead on. It was amazing. So I asked Aaron Vanek if they had the video for that, and they do, but the audio's not that great. For that particular reading, so I contacted Torin, and I think I've got him talked into doing an actual audio that I can share with everybody, an audio reading of that. That same audio reading, just, you know, better quality audio. So it was amazing. I don't think I've ever heard a reading like that.
I only saw the interview after, that's how I know who the voices were that Lehman gave, but I assume Christopher Walken was Randolph Carter.
I think so.
Pauly Warren. That would kind
yes.
of.
Yeah. Now, who's the guy that goes down into the crypt? I forget.
Harley Warren.
Harley Warren. It was Harley Warren.
Yeah.
Yeah. Christopher Walken. He read Harley Warren in the voice of Christopher Walken. So anyway, it was great. So I had a really great time. Thanks, Cody and Aaron. Thanks, everybody. Aaron put me up for a night after... Well, they put me up in a hotel, but they put me up for a night and took me to the airport, brought me back. So I really appreciate it. I won't beat a dead horse, but I appreciate it. I thought maybe we could spend a couple of minutes talking about... Here's my question. And no, Kelly Young did not feed me this one. What were the highlights of the festival for you? Why don't I start with you, Matt?
Can you all hear me?
Yep.
Yep.
Okay, my video's frozen. I just can't tell. Okay.
Okay, no problem.
Well, I thought I wanted to go and see things anywhere else. So, for me, the highlight, the absolute best thing, was they did a 10-minute clip. It wasn't even final rendering, but it was partly complete for the animated movie Howard Lovecraft and the Frozen Kingdom. Now, if y'all are not familiar with this, this was a comic book that came out roughly in 2008. And frankly, I thought it was mediocre. I didn't like the art. I thought the dialogue was silly. I thought it was anachronistic. But okay, just someone else cashing in on the Lovecraft thing. And he published two sequels. Well, it turns out, now I'm going to forget the name here, the guy who runs an animation studio is either a friend of his or somehow enamored of it. And they've decided to make it into an animated movie. A roughly 80 to 90 minute animated movie. So full length. And just the first comic book, not all three of them. Well, the animation is a lot better for me than the original artwork. It is very much along the lines of Paranorman or Coraline, although I don't think they use puppets. I think it's all computer rendered. The vocal talent is spectacular.
They have Ron Christopher Perlman and Christopher Plummer,
Lovecraft, and then Dr. West. They have Jane Curtin. They have Jane Curtin, who's doing a major character, and they have Ron Perlman being the evil villain. I mean, that's A-list vocal talent for a cartoon.
And yeah, he plays a shark, doesn't he?
It's a little bit creepy at the beginning where they're going to visit Howard's father in the asylum. Him and his mom are going there. That's going to be a little bit creepy when he starts saying things to Howard. That I wonder how that would play with little kids. But after that, I don't think it's any more Paranorman. And it looks to me like this could actually be a breakout movie for Lovecraftian.
Yeah.
Plans to distribute. But I was really super impressed that this is going to be I think this is a potential to be a smash. So that for me was the highlight, was seeing that.
Wow, just in time that he kicked out. That was beautiful timing. Yeah, his computer's not liking Google Hangout today. What about you, Kelly?
Oh, I think like you, the highlight for all of these kind of conventions is to hang out with friends that I only get to see, once or twice a year. So that was the biggest deal for me, was hanging out with everybody. The night that you turned in early, a lot of us, including Joe Pulver and Sam Cowan, ended up sitting outside the hotel and drinking scotch and catching up with everybody. And John Skip had joined us, and that was a really lovely conversation about life, the universe, and everything. So that was probably the highlight for me. I'm sure.
What about you, Joe? I should mention, and I got to meet S.P. Miskowski in person, so that's another highlight.
That was cool. Well,
Joe, you there?
Yeah, I had to.
There you go.
I had to turn my microphone on, but Google didn't want to turn it on, so it took a minute. It was one highlight after another for me. I was privileged and honored to be the guest of honor, so that was something. Of course, the opportunity to hang out with my friends is paramount to everything. Our first night there, about a half a dozen of us took a short walk to look around, and we wound up on a plain old street corner next to an empty lot, and we stood there for at least an hour just talking and joking, and that was just utterly wonderful. The evening that we spent at the hotel with Kelly and Brian and Gwen Callahan and Nick from Chaosium and, of course, John Skip, who was wonderful. One evening, I stood outside the theater with John Skip, and him and I had an extremely lengthy conversation that was well over an hour on craft. Felt like I had met a brother that I didn't know I had. SP was there. I finally got to meet SP Miskowski, which was a very, very great pleasure for me. She's absolutely wonderful. And her, I love her husband, too. Great, great guy. her new chapbook was, that was the release for it on Dim Shores. Dim Shores also released this. This is the hardcover version of Michael Sisko's Lost, The Knife Dance.
Oh, yeah, he signed those hardcovers, too.
Yes, as did Harry O. Morris, as an introduction by Paul Tremblay. My very great pleasure to have curated the entirety of the project. I'm delighted to see it finally find a release after 20 years, or, well, 19 years. Sam did an amazing job producing this book. It's stunning to look at. The hardcover is filled with Harry O. Morris's full-color artwork. So that was a great thing after all these years, almost two full decades, hold this in my hand. It's long been a dream of mine to let the public see this great work, which Sisko destroyed all those years ago. He wasn't happy with it. I had been at a reading. I had a hard copy, which, of course, didn't get destroyed, and I've been waiting forever to get it published. And Sam...
And Sam Cowan is doing a great job in general at Dim Shores, too, I might add.
Phenomenal. Phenomenal. These chapbooks that he's producing... just look at, I mean, look at the last year for Necronomicon when he did the Necronomicon Round Robin chapbook, The Doom That Came to Providence. I threw ideas at him, like I wanted Ears Mike to look like tweets. Justin Steele's entry looked like a handbill that a cultist might hand out. Tom Lynch's entry looked like a real police report. Damian Angelica Walters looked like something a high school student had written and then crumbled up and thrown out. Every idea I tossed at Sam, he's like, yeah, we can do that. Yeah, we can do that. And it looked amazing. All his books look amazing. When you look at the quality, the talent of the writers he's publishing in these chapbooks, it's truly wonderful. He's doing things by established writers. He's also doing things by newer writers who show vast, vast amounts of talent and promise. Dim Shores is just hitting home run after home run. I can't praise Sam and his publishing concern enough.
Yeah, for those listening, it's let me give the URL for Sam, though, real quick. It's www.dimshores.com, just like it sounds. You can also just Google Dim Shores Press, and it's the first or second result. So, yeah, check out his press, definitely.
Another thing that made it a high point is in addition to SP and Cisco having new releases launched there, this was launched. This is The Lure of Devouring Light by Michael Griffin. It's his debut collection.
That was on my list of notes to mention today, so I'm glad you brought it up.
It's a great book. I have been very privileged to be behind the curtain with Mike for a very long time in regards to aspects of this book. I'm a huge fan. One of the things, and this may ultimately be the highlight for me, is, I don't know if you can see that, it's the dedication, and it says to Joe Pulver, who taught me how to open the vein, and Mike Davis was standing there when I was handed this book and was told to look on that page, and Mike Davis might tell you that I instantly put my sunglasses on to hide tears, but we know Mike Davis is a dirty, rotten liar. I was not crying.
Didn't say a word.
I was not crying behind my sunglasses. I might have been a little watery, maybe. So I couldn't be more honored that this book, which I consider a great book, was dedicated to me. I couldn't have been more shocked. The panels were wonderful. I was treated wonderfully. hanging out. There's a million stories about hanging out that I can tell you. One of the things I would like to talk about for a minute, though, is on three occasions, I mean, I signed a million books. People brought copies of Blood Will Have Its Season. People brought copies of Nightmare's Disciple. People brought copies of House of Hollow Wounds. You know, some people had four different books by me. Some people had one. Some people had three. You know, one person had everything. But on three occasions, people came up and, hi, Mr. Pulver, my name is such and such, and I just want to thank you. I really love such and such a story or such and such a book, and blah, blah, blah. And all three at some point in the conversation said, oh, I'm sorry, I'm just a fan. I'm sorry if I'm bothering you. Okay, so let's take a minute and talk to just fans. You are not simply fans. We are nothing without you. Do not demean yourself by saying, I'm just a fan. We work in the dark. We work alone. We produce something. When we're done, we hope it gets into your hands. We hope you read it. We hope you enjoy it. It's a dance. It's a tango. I'm attempting to lead. When it's in your hands, hopefully I've done my job and you get to enjoy the dance.
I told everybody to call you Mr. Pulver and that you don't like to be bothered.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Joe. I have to disagree. It's not a tango. It's a pasodoble.
Okay. I like it as a tango. But the point is they are not simply just people out there. Two of the people, I had the impression that they have been at conventions and approached creators they like to say thank you and would you sign this? And people had the gall to look down on their nose at them. We are absolutely nothing without our readership. Anyone who, if you're approached by someone who has a copy of your book or a story, a book, an anthology you have a story in. And, you know, hi, I really like your stuff. Would you please sign this for me? That's high tribute. If you get tired of signing books, if you think these people are unworthy, then you're the unworthy one.
You know what you just reminded me of? I had one copy of a book at this festival last weekend, and your author that you're putting on a pedestal here, Mike Griffin, kept stealing it.
Wait a second, he's not the only one.
Matt Carpenter did it too.
No. You gave away gifts you didn't want to
well,
give.
Well, I saw that's the book not somewhere. True. I saw the book at somewhere and took possession of it.
I took it to lunch.
It kept moving around, and I feared it would get lost and you would be upset.
Wow, that's nice of you.
But
that's what Mike Griffin said too.
It was a great convention. Mike, you know how hard it is for you and I to walk, and you know where the hotel was. One morning, I was coming out, and I just looked up the street and went, yeah, I got 2 hours to get to the top of the hill. It's just going to be interesting. And
well, I have to say that getting back to the hotel was relatively easy, no matter how I felt, because it was all downhill.
I could have rolled, but up that hill was no fun. But a couple of people who I've met at other conventions, fans, and I don't mean that in a bad way, I mean that in the best possible way, came out in the morning and the other, and what are you doing? Oh, I'm trying to gear up mentally to get up the hill. Oh, well, they ran and got their car, drove me, which gestures, wonderful, wonderful people. And on the way up, it's like, do you need anything? I'm like, hopefully I can find some place to find tea, because I need something for breakfast. Well, they went out, and I think they bought all the tea in San Pedro for me and delivered it. I was very touched by that. I spent a ton of time engaged in various length of conversations with readers and fans, all of which was wonderful. I had a great time listening to what they had to say. Of course, it was all very praiseworthy. It's a great community. I mean, we've all said it innumerable times. We will keep saying it. We are privileged to be part of it. We are, I think, very privileged to be creators in this community. Where our work.
Well, I'll tell you what I'm getting from this conversation, Joe.
I'm sorry?
You mentioned your highlights. I tell you what I'm getting from this conversation. You mentioned your highlights, and you have not once mentioned the fact, the highlight of Kelly being there, Matt being there, and me being there. I would assume those were number one, two, and three.
Wait a minute. I said I wanted to touch on something, and then I move along. I didn't get there yet.
If you want to touch on Mike, it's going to be off the air, okay?
it's always a great privilege and pleasure to see my wingman Kelly Young. He knows how much I love him. Matt Carpenter.
I thought you were my wingman.
No.
Even from that first time in Portland all those years ago, I thought we'd establish you're my wingman.
Carpenter was
just wonderful. He brought a bottle of Glenlivet to the writer's reading panel.
He won the convention with that.
He was deeply appreciated by the writers. Mike Griffin's eyes turned, you know, kid at Christmas. The plastic cups came out. So there were your, you know, high-class Lovecraftian writers with the cheapest little plastic cups in the universe drinking very, very good scotch. Thanks, Matt Carpenter.
Kelly Young's drinking some right now.
It looks like he is.
Always, actually.
I didn't see Matt a whole ton. He was busy watching films. It was wonderful every time you saw him, though. Oh, I just saw this, and it was. He seemed like he was a kid at a fun fair. He seemed like he was having a great time.
Well, I did. I went to the Dunwich Horror Picture Show, which was a brilliant concept. If I had been more awake, I probably would have liked it better because of the time change and the jet lag. But they took the Dunwich Horror. They turned off the music score. They had a live band on kind of improvising a music score. Yep. They had a local theater company kind of acting it out like you act out the Rocky Horror Picture Show. They had people in costumes, including Wilbur's brother. They inserted little clips of film that
Frank Woodward recut it.
Yeah, that famous John Travolta moving around like he's not knowing what he's doing from Pulp Fiction. That made it in there. And then they had some guy making sardonic comments like Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Yeah.
And from a really almost unwatchable movie, it was actually quite entertaining.
And there were moments where the crowd was just lost at laughing. At one point, there's a cut, and all of a sudden, here's Jimi Hendrix, Are You Experienced, blasting away. I was just, that's perfect. Frank Woodward did an incredible job cutting that. Concept was great.
All of this was illegal, so they aren't ever going to show it again, and they couldn't live stream it or videotape it, so that was your one chance.
There's no way they could film it and release it because of licensing and whatnot. Of course, Mike Davis was there, one of my great dear friends, so it's always incredible to see him. Just one evening after the convention, I stayed at Cody Goodfellow's for a couple of days, and that was wonderful hanging out with him. But one evening, Frank Woodward came over, and we hung out on Cody's patio and talked for about 3 hours. Absolutely fabulous time just standing there talking to Frank. He's so knowledgeable. He's so nice, so friendly. And I've liked Frank in the past, and we've talked, but we've never had a ton of time to sit and talk. So there were things like that. One end to the other. Every time I turned around, great. I can't say enough.
Last thing I'd like to say about it, just real quick, is I had several people come up to me and say that they listen to the audio podcast version of this show frequently, like on their way to work and so forth. People I've never heard from, a couple I did. But that was a nice little shot in the arm, so thanks to those of you who did that.
And there were certainly people who mentioned the fact that, I see Joe, I see you're not on sometimes, and Mike will say you're ill, and I see sometimes Mike cancels a show because he's ill. And really sorry that you guys aren't healthy and that you suffer like that. Just all kinds of really wonderful people on every level. So that was fantastic.
And now let's talk about Kelly Young's package. The movie.
Well, all right, if we must.
Kelly Young had created a short film called The Package, actually. I don't know what all of you were thinking. And it's, two minutes long, Kelly? And I think you won the audience award, the applause meter, something like that. you and I were watching movies in the theater, and the applause was pretty good on each movie, depending on the movie. And then after your movie ended, it just went wild. So anyway, probably not much. I don't know how much you can really say about the movie without spoiling it. But
yeah, it's
you
want to
set it up a little bit.
It's basically a setup and a punchline at the end. So the setup, of course, is the way just about every Lovecraft story begins. And I don't want to give away the punchline. But
right.
the response was humbling. I had no idea it was going to go over so well. And then Aaron came up to me before they announced the winners, and he's like, "Oh, man, it was so close, you know, within 3 votes." And I was like, "Hey, you're kidding me. Audience award within 3 votes. I almost got it." And he said, "Yeah, I'm so sorry." And I said, "What are you sorry about? That's amazing. I got that close? I had no idea." You know, although the response was amazing. And then the rest of that night, I had people wandering up and telling me how much they loved it. So that was a big thrill. And from here it goes to Worldcon, another Hole in the Head film festival, and a couple other festivals that I can't quite remember right now. That was kind of stupid of me not to actually think of which ones were coming up, but it's been accepted at several festivals.
If you're not going to any of those festivals, or if you're going and don't catch it, for those who are interested in seeing this, and I really recommend that you do see it, because you will not regret having taken up 2 minutes of your time with this film. Is it ever going to come out, say, on Vimeo or something after it's made the film festival circuit, or have you even thought that far ahead?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. We'll put it out there after it's done the festival circuit. But while we're still sending it out, I don't want anybody to turn it down just because it's readily available.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. I have a little announcement. Chelsea Goodwin wants me to announce that, I'm just going to read this. Would you let people know that Daryl Schweitzer and Maddie Brahan will be at Steampunk in the Catskills with Jeff Mock, and friends at the Blackthorn Resort in East Dunham, New York on June 10th to 12th. We want all the Lovecraft fans we can get. So she had emailed me about this previously, and I had never heard of this particular con or whatever it is before. It sounds interesting. So, I don't know. I'm assuming there are a lot more people out there who know more about this. So, anyway, and Paula Grand sent me this. I think it's out right now. The Mammoth Book of Cthulhu, with stories by Laird Barron, Brian Hodge, Caitlin R. Kiernan, John Langan, John Shirley, and many more. Actually looks pretty good. So, Nadia Bulkin's in it. So, anyway, I want to let people know about that. I'll post about that on the Lovecraft eZine page tomorrow. I have a. This is interesting. Something I wanted to bring up with you guys. I noticed that, and of course I didn't bring it up. They're doing. Ellen Datlow and somebody else is doing a. Is doing blind submissions for an anthology. Do you remember the name of that anthology, Kelly? I'm trying to remember what it was.
I don't. The picture had F. Paul Wilson on it. Wasn't it a WHA anthology?
Yeah, it is. It's got a title.
It's an HWA anthology. Horror Writers of America anthology?
That's right. HWA, sorry.
Yeah. Anyway, I thought, I don't think I've seen that a lot. Have you guys? Basically, she's going to be reading the stories and not know who sent them in. Kind of interesting.
Yeah, I think that's super interesting. I think that Ellen Datlow is maybe one of the people we don't have to worry about not accepting stories based on, you know, whether you're a woman or what color you are or what any of that stuff. So it, you know, her doing that, it just sends a message that this is something that can be done. But I feel like she's always kind of done that.
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't recall, maybe it's happened and I just haven't noticed it, that having been done much. And I'm not saying it's interesting in the as a euphemism for I'm criticizing, because I'm not. It's just something different, so it's interesting to talk about.
I kind of remember anthologies where you were assigned a number and that you used that number on all your documents so that you... But that was decades ago, I think.
Yeah, before we get further into this, you just said blind submissions. Let's explain what that means to maybe someone who's not a writer.
Yeah, good point.
It means you have to put your eyes out if you want to submit to the...
Well, I've read some stuff that you've written.
If it offends you.
And why blind submissions is an important thing, because there's been some issues coming up lately.
Yeah, you want to explain that, Kelly?
Well, there's been a lot of talk about writers who are not being accepted into anthologies or whatever they're applying for or submitting to based on either their race, their gender, maybe even, religious stuff. So a blind submission would then be the person who is reading these stories for this anthology would have none of that knowledge up front. So they would then have to base their feelings of this story only on the story.
Right.
And this was done extensively in the past by Des Lewis with Pneumonious. Those first 10 annual volumes, he did not know, and he did not, when he selected them and published them, he did not publish them with bylines. In the next issue, you would get the byline for the previous volume.
That's cool.
Which was very, very interesting experiment. It was very well received. In addition to what Kelly's talking about, the outcry about diversity, there is also significant outcry saying all these anthologies are invite only. And speaking as an editor, I'm putting together a book. I have room for 20 stories, and I have a theme. I might have 60 people on my invite list, and I'll sit and put them in order, and I'll start sending out emails. I often, send out 20, 23 emails, and it's the end of the day, I'm going to send out a bunch more tomorrow. When I open my inbox the next morning, I normally have yes, if everyone delivers, the book's full. I don't invite 45 people to a book where I'm going to have approximately 20 slots. I don't want them working for nothing. The outrage about, these books are closed, it's invite only, that happens. Whether you're Mike Davis or Joe Pulver or Ellen Datlow or Ross Lockhart or whoever, you're putting together a book and Mike knows how much I adore Nadia Bulkin's work, and
there are anthologies out there that are open submissions too.
There's a degree of outrage over that all anthologies are not.
But But can I just say, there is a degree of outrage over everything.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, to be honest, let's go to a different art form. Yeah. Most symphony orchestras now, to eliminate even the whisper of bias, have true blind auditions, where the person auditioning for the part, there's a screen between them and the director and the people who are auditioning for the orchestra.
So that
they don't even see the gender, race, or anything, or there's a buddy of theirs, and it's purely by the sound of the music. Mm-hmm. So it's like maybe we're all headed that way just to eliminate the whisper of bias. But I got to say, when I did my anthology, and we've got another one coming up, it may as well have been blind because I didn't know who the hell anybody was. You know, it's like I just read, and I didn't even look. I just read the story. Did I like it or not? You know, that's not.
So here's what I want to ask. For by the way, I found that it's called Hallow's Eve, and it looks like it's edited by Ellen Datlow and Lisa Morton. So, and I asked this not with the okay, I know the answer, and you guys better get to it, anything like that. I think it's worthy of discussion. When you do an open submission, this is open to members of the HWA, so to an extent it's open submissions, as if I understand this correctly. Okay, let me add that. To that extent, it is open submissions. It's not, Ellen's not sending out invites. That is my understanding. So this is a great example to use. I'm not really picking on All Hallows Eve, or pardon me, Hallows Eve. It's just kind of an example that came up that I wanted to talk about. Is this, you know, I think just about, yeah, everybody here has edited a book or a magazine. Is this the way to go, in you guys' opinion, with an open submission process? Should you do blind invites? Then you have the other school of thought that you should not do blind invites because you need to make sure that it's diverse enough. I have seen that comment from many people, let's put it that way. So ask that question, what do you guys think?
It's one way to go, but it's not the only way to go. And one other thing in regards to invite only. I read as widely as I can read. So along comes Matthew Bartlett. Along comes Nadia Boken. Along comes Christopher Slatsky. Along comes Michael Wehunt. Along comes Nicole Cushing. Now, some of these people have been around a little while now. But I'm looking, I hear about them, I see people compliment them. I'm actively looking for their work. And where I find their work resonates and I find I'm interested in their work, then they go on my radar. And it's a question of what anthology I'm working on that I feel they'll fit with the theme, you know, their writing style, whatever, the way they think or the way I believe they'll approach the tale.
Yeah, I understand that.
It's not a submission, but my role as a writer, and I use Datlow as an example here, Datlow reads widely. Datlow is in search of. A good editor is in search of new voices. You may be on an editor's radar, but they haven't found the place to plug you in yet. I've received messages from people, really love what you're doing, would love to be in your book, a book you're doing one day. And there's a couple of people in Caligari. It's my first opportunity to work with. They were invited. They were on my radar. A couple of things that I'm working on next. I've invited new people, too, because they've been on my radar, and I've been waiting for the right opportunity to work with them. We are not trying to keep anyone out. What we're trying to do is assemble what we feel will be a really good book. We have our favorites. We have people we're interested in. I mean, we're almost like movie directors. You know, I never got to direct such and such, and I want to work with him or her. It's just what movie, in this case book, works with. Do I think they fill that role? This is, I would say, if you look at Datlow, if you look at Ross Lockhart, hell, if you look at me, we are inclusive. There's women in the books, and not one. There are people who are LGBT. There are people of color. There are people of various religions. I'm all for diversity. More diversity is better for us as readers. But that's simply one element. It's not the only element. At the end of the day, it's the quality of the work. I feel bad we're in the 21st century and we have to address issues like, well, we need to be promoting women. I've always promoted women. Hell, you know, I was an 8-year-old kid. I bought a Classics Illustrated comic book that I adored. It was called Frankenstein. It said Mary Shelley on the cover. That was
that covers invite. That covers invite only. But I'm curious about open submissions and what you guys think about.
You might find some gems, but mostly what you're going to find, I think, is crap.
Can I talk about it?
Yeah.
Yeah, Salome, please.
So we've done those two, not to intrude on what Joe is saying. We've done two cosmic horror weird fiction to offend Kelly anthologies because he hates the term weird fiction. And they have both been open submission, but I did invite some people. The first one, I invited some people because I didn't get enough good stories out of open submissions. And I only got one woman. So that was my first shot at a completely open submission process. And then I needed five more stories, and so I just asked writers that I knew could do it to write me things. And I don't have a lot of cosmic horror writing contacts. Well, I have more now than I used to. But I, you know, I'm a literary and spec fic writer, not necessarily cosmic horror, so my connections were not in that area. The second book, I think because the call was posted on the Lovecraft eZine, and because there was a previous book, I got, 150 submissions. Mm-hmm. And most of them were not what I was looking for various reasons. I mean, you do get a lot of things that are just not what you're looking for because writers are inexperienced or they don't have a background in the kind of writing you're asking them to do or whatever reason. But I got quite a lot of good stories, but I got a lot of good stories that needed some work. What I usually try to do is have a mix of people who are known writers of that sort of thing, at least one or two known writers, and the rest being new writers, because I'm interested in new writers, and I want to help them make connections with known writers. But I can see why a bigger publisher would not want to do this, because it's overwhelming for the anthology you have coming out. I got more than 400 submissions. It took me months to just look at all of them. Not even read all of them, but just look at them like a general, what's the quality of this story? I feel compelled to read, like, at least a couple of paragraphs, even if it's complete gibberish that I would never think of publishing, because this book is going to have 7 very well-known, long-established writers in it, and I want the level of the work of the new writers to be comparable to those. It was really hard to find that. So, you know, there are some open submissions, and those are places where new writers can get started, and then they get their work into a book, and if it turns out to be good, that will help them become visible to editors who are less likely to do the open submission process. I just think random open submissions, you know, everyone believes in their heart that I'm actually a writer because they know how to write letters on a page and words and sentences. And they don't necessarily understand that writing a story isn't just like writing anything. You will really get pages and pages of something that is not only not a story, I don't know, it defies explanation.
That's Salome, there's no other profession that someone would say, I can do that as much as there is in writing, because everyone can type on a keyboard.
Exactly.
And so, for some reason, that makes them think that they can also write.
Yes, and maybe they can. Maybe eventually they can. But it's not just something you do like that. From Harlan Ellison, maybe? Not too many people can just write good stories without a lot of work. Write 1,000,000 bad words first, and then you'll write something good. And how many people are going to stick with it that long?
Yeah.
Well, so yeah, I don't want to get into the invite only, you know, because Strange Eons is invite only. Right. But really what I see, this is just a statement being made, because the people who are making it, Ellen Dadlow or any of these other people, are the people we don't have to worry about being prejudiced against a writer based on their race, religion, gender.
Yeah, so, definitely agree.
So maybe this statement is strong enough that other people will pick it up, and that'll become the norm. And so it's good for that reason. But when Ellen Dadlow does that, it's fantastic. But we never had to worry about her anyway. Waving his hand around and disagreeing with me.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not disagreeing with you, but I also know how things happen. Look, if you're Ellen Dadlow and you've got 50 good stories and you can pick 10, and you've got a story from Neil Gaiman, that's going in, right?
Absolutely.
You get a story from Stephen King, it's going in. And this is not out of the realm of possibilities. You know, you get a story from Peter Stroud, Caitlin Kiernan. Oh, that's 5 stories right there. That's half your book. It doesn't matter how good those other stories are. You cannot turn down those stories, because those stories will help sell the book.
Mm-hmm.
So I get that. Kelly just caught up to me. I get that. You know, we don't have to worry about it.
There's a whole text conversation going on here. But yeah, I don't want to interrupt you, Pete. Go ahead.
We don't have to worry about a bias, but there is a bias because, you know, big names sell books, and you're going to take them if you can get them.
Yeah, you're saying there's not a bias in many great editors' minds, if I understand you correctly, with as regards to race, sex, religion, whatever, but there is. They, you know, Neil Gaiman sells books, for example.
Stephen King sells books. Caitlin Kiernan sells books, I think.
Cult of Personality.
Well, yeah. So, you know, it's hard to sit there and look at those books and say, I'm not going to take those stories.
That's a really good point.
You know?
But if your book is mermaids, and Neil Gaiman sends you a mermaid story, odds are it's pretty good.
Yeah.
If not incredible, why, if it fits the theme and it's a really good story, why wouldn't you take it?
Yeah,
or you take anything else.
Right. There's a comic strip that Neil did called Where Do I Get My Ideas? And he's like, oh, well, you know, they come from the cosmic void. I just reach out and I grab them. And it's like, oh, this is an idea for a funny cat book. Really? A funny cat book? They just toss it to the side. And he just keeps reaching up and grabbing ideas. And there are these horrible ideas. And he's like, I really need an introduction to this, you know, book of ghost stories by H.R. Wakefield or whoever. And he's like, finally at the end, he's like, can I have that funny cat book story idea back? Because, you know, I'm going to use that as the introduction. Yeah, because, frankly, Neil could sell me shit on a shingle at this point.
Yeah.
And I'd be happy.
And perhaps part of the reason, I'm not certainly not speaking for Alan Dallow or Lisa Morton, but perhaps part of the reason why they can do blind submissions here is because they know they're only getting submissions from members of the HWA. So at least there's going to be some level of quality there.
Right. So, well, Salome just
I'm not
said,
here to say what's right or what's wrong. I think these topics are worthy of discussion, you know. So.
Well, Salome just said she got 450 submissions. I'm working on Caligari. When I signed the contract, Dennis wanted the book delivered in 7 months. I don't have time to read 450 submissions. Especially when you put that up against, I can already envision roughly who and what I want. That's nice. But then again, Mike, you publish a magazine. Kelly's published. I've published. Peter's read through slush files. Matt's read through slush files. And when you get 450 submissions, you have a big slush file. Now, Salome is a very lovely person. She's a sweetheart. She'll sit there and read a couple pages. If your first sentence or your first paragraph sucks, I stop reading and move on. It's a waste of my time. It's a waste of any editor's time. If you can't deliver... And we've all seen things where the grammatical errors or the lack of talent in a first paragraph are prevalent. No one's going to spend any more time with this piece, and I would say, nor should we.
Agreed.
Yes, development of the writer is important, but there are... Okay, Gemophiles has been around...
I think Salome wanted to say something, actually. Salome?
No, I was just going to say, I call it green crayon syndrome.
What's that?
That's funny.
Explain that, Salome.
What did I miss?
What Joe is saying, where you can tell from the first paragraph, it looks like it's written in green crayon. It's just like,
yeah.
Why did they send this? Oh, my God. Bring it up.
I got to tell this story. Years ago, I was hiring for a position, and I had a stack of 30 qualified people, and I was only going to interview 3. Mm-hmm. So I'm going through the piles looking for any reason to throw these people away, and I get a call from HR, Human Resources, and they say, this one girl would like to add something to her resume. Can she fax you something? She just finished some coursework. Well, yeah, sure, if it's relevant. Go ahead. So I get this fax, and it's a fax of a cocktail napkin in eyeliner.
What?
So she took a cocktail napkin with her eyeliner and wrote the coursework and the code and the grade she got and faxed that.
My
wow. Category. And you're hired.
And you hired her.
All right. So I understand the
That's great. Yeah, well, you know, if you're doing an invite only and you don't have diversity, then you know, there's a real fucking problem there. You know, because you obviously made the choice to invite 25 white guys, you know?
Well,
so, you know.
Let me just say something on that, because, you know, this was, I would say, 75% a reprint anthology. Mm-hmm. And I was on a tight deadline. So there's the other factor that comes into play. I need 5 stories in 2 months.
Right.
I'm not putting out an open call. I invited 7 people. I got 5 stories. And they all got in the book. But not because I didn't want, I wanted to exclude anybody. I simply did not have the time to read 200 stories about Herbert West. It wasn't going to happen. We had to get this book out in 2015.
Yep.
So, well, and we worked with, you know, Rick and I went back and forth on his story a half dozen times.
Yeah.
Well, can it happen? Can it happen? Sure, but, you know, if there's a repeated pattern of it happening with an editor, obviously it's a huge issue. I mean, that's an understatement. You know, I just, you know, we do, just as an example, when we are open at Lovecraft eZine, the magazine, it's open submissions. You know, so I'm curious about things like this. Should we be reading without regard, without knowing the person's name, you know, or not? You know, I don't claim to have any answers. I just, again, think these things are worth talking about.
Well, so. I think a good editor isn't persuaded or dissuaded by a name. I mean, a big name, yes. But other than that, it's like, you know, what's the story?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say you're
I don't know. Pete Rolick could send me his grocery list and I'd publish it because he's Pete Rolick. Sorry, Kelly, what?
Well, I was going to say, Ed, Joe touched on it, but I was going to say your publisher is going to be upset if you turned out a story from Stephen King because you didn't think it was up to snuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure Stephen King can take notes, man. Yeah. Write a couple of notes on his thing and he'll fix it for you.
But here's the other thing, Mike. Editors, I see this, editors get very comfortable with people they've worked with for a long time.
Yes.
And as that editor grows older, as the editor grows older, his stable grows older with him. And it's rare that anybody can ever break into that stable because, you know, if you keep putting out good work, you're never going to get kicked back. You know,
all right. There's some validity in that, Pete.
I hear you.
I disagree because, yes, I've already.
Oh, not all old people.
I've already probably started to establish a stable of writers that I like working with. I like their work. I know what they do. I know how they do it. But I'm also bringing in new people every time. Maybe not a ton, but some.
Right.
I think that's important. I'm bringing in people that, well, again, I'll mention Nadia Bulkin. Someone I think the world of. Like Mike Griffin. Nadia Bulkin is someone I want to see a collection. I want to see this person succeed on a high level, and I want it yesterday. She's an amazing writer, unbelievably talented, worthy in the extreme. And Mike knows this. When Mike was getting to do Autumn Cthulhu, it was a name I recommended to Mike. He ultimately invited her based on my recommendation. She blew his socks off. But she's a newer writer. Gemma Files is not a new writer. Gemma Files has been around 20 years. I think she is perhaps the most underrated, undervalued writer out there. I've never read anything by her I didn't absolutely adore. I think her talents are vast.
If she is underrated, it won't be for long because of experimental fiction.
Yeah,
you know, his novels are more popular.
Hopefully that amazing work puts her where she belongs. But it's my privilege to work with her and to be able to, in whatever small way I can, promote her work. This is a writer that should be read widely, very, very widely. And she's not. Well, not enough to please me as a reader. Go ahead, Pete.
I agree with you. The only caveat is that I would say is that new writers are new when you discover them. I can remember walking into a Barnes & Noble about 5 years ago, and on the shelf was the new and emerging writer section was Joe Lansdale.
Mm.
And I was like, I've been reading Lansdale for 25 years.
Yeah.
But, suddenly he had, I guess it was like the early Happ and Leonard novels.
Mm-hmm.
They were suddenly breaking out in the mystery section, and, for everybody who hadn't read him, he was a new writer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, that is the caveat to this, is that you can be hidden away in your genre for decades, and then you move into a new area, and suddenly you're new.
This whole thing is all different kinds of possibilities and reasons why and reasons that didn't. The other thing too is you edited a book and you had 22 people say yes, and at some point 3 people bow out. Life gets in the way, this got in the way, blah, blah, blah. And perhaps at that point you start scrambling to fill those slots. And, instead of the 9 months lead time you gave all the other writers, you're down to, you got 3 months. So who perhaps his schedule isn't filled, who still fits your idea? There's any number of possibilities. One way or another.
About 2 years ago, I got a phone call from one of our common friends and said, "Look, I've got a 8,000-word hole in this anthology. I need a story, and I need it Monday. Can you do something?" And you don't. And we'll pay you extra if you can get it done.
Yeah.
Don't say no. You got to give it a shot. But is that going to be your best work? No.
I really agree with, everything Salome said, but one thing really jumps out at me is, you have an anthology with some, whatever pond you're in, some big names, and you can get some great stories by someone who isn't well-known or maybe even hasn't been published before. That's good, too, because your job as an editor, at least I feel, is to find new talent. So I know Salome did that with her 2 Cthulhu books. And I've got some big names in Autumn Cthulhu, but then I've got a couple that have great stories that I don't think anyone's heard of much yet, so hopefully, they'll hear more about them.
Mike, that sending you that story was really nerve-wracking for me.
Why is that?
because it was completely unlike anything I'd ever written before. It's not
That's
overtly
true.
It's not what you expect from me. So I was surprised when you took it.
Well, it was what I was looking for, you know. And sometimes, you know, like Damien's story, I didn't know what I was looking for until she showed me a different version of what I was looking for, and that just, it was great. So, anyway, speaking of Autumn Cthulhu, if you're a backer, your books are going out. If you're one of the writers, your books have gone out. And there's what the book looks like. Here's what the alternate, if you're a backer and you got this, here's what the alternate cover looks like.
Oh, man, I love that.
So.
That's a thick
book. Oh, thank you. Yeah, it is. This is by Dave Felton. So, and the author's names, you probably can't read them, are on the tombstone. So, anyway, I just wanted to let all the backers know, Thanks for being patient with me. I'm a few weeks later than I thought it would be, but the books are going out.
Something about the book, because I got to read a few stories before Stoneman stole it back. I was kind of undergoing a crisis of confidence about Cthulhu. It's like, have we come to the end of Cthulhu anthologies? Is there really anything left to say? I mean, I got a book in the mail. It's Redneck Eldritch, okay, about essentially hillbillies in Cthulhu. And then I saw on Amazon like Shoggoth Butt Invaders. Okay, what we're left with is like dinosaur porn and the biggest stretch anthologies you could possibly imagine. But then I picked up Autumn Cthulhu, and it's great. I mean, I'd read like a third of it before I had to give it up. So I'm waiting for it to come back in the mail. It really is good.
Well, thanks. It's due to the great writers that are in it. So, but I'm really glad you liked it. You can buy this on Amazon now if you're listening to this. Go to Amazon and type in Autumn Cthulhu. I think Rick has a Lovecraftian story about the convention he was just at.
Yeah, I went to Windy City Pulp Convention in Chicago at the end of April. And when I came home, I opened my suitcase that I had checked in at the airport. It was on a carry-on. And I found this notice from the Transportation Security Administration, in English and Spanish, that my bag had been searched for a contraband item. So they must have suspected I was carrying on a weapon that would destroy the aircraft.
Did you have a copy of the Necronomicon in your suitcase?
This is what I had, a piggy bank in the shape of great...
I gave that away as a prize once. That's why they searched your bag?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Which means either this looks like a bomb...
Or somebody recognized it on the screen and said, I want to see that.
Or
that's probably what happened.
The federal government is worried that people are carrying Cthulhu idols on aircraft to drive the passengers mad.
They should be.
So there it is again.
It should be.
We should all like get the same idol and put it in our bag on the way home from Portland or Necronomicon and see if anything happens.
That's a great Lovecraftian story.
Wow.
That's awesome.
I think this is proof that the Innsmouth raid really happened.
The government
is looking for Cthulhu idols.
Yeah. A$AP Hale, who I think readers of the Lovecraft eZine blog may recognizes his name by now. Right before the show, he sent me a Facebook message, and he told me about a, how long is this thing, 15, 16-minute short film on Vimeo, and it's called Here We Are. And I want to especially mention it now because he told me it's, I've not seen it yet. I'm going to watch it tonight or tomorrow because it looks really good. He said it's only available for the next week or so, something like that, and then they're going to take it off Vimeo. And he said it's really good, and he's, if ASAP says it's good, I'm sure it is good. Let's put it that way. Says two science students, say that five times real fast, travel to a remote part of Iceland to test a large-scale magnetic theory. But what they encounter is something larger than themselves with ramifications that might go beyond the scope of the experiment. So that sounds pretty cosmic horror to me, so I can't wait to watch it. So if you want some great, I'm assuming, Lovecraftian entertainment for 15 minutes, again, go to Vimeo, and the name of the movie is Here We Are, by a guy named Fabian Dubois. Dubois? I don't know. Anyway, looks really good. I really like that premise. Did you see, he also said he liked Black Mountainside because he rented it. I have no opinion on Black Mountainside because, and it looks good, and I did see it because I could not, maybe it's my hearing because I'm deaf in one ear. When they played it at the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival, Kelly and I were sitting on the balcony, and part of the movie there's this, like, what would you call it, this deep bass, Kelly, in the movie?
Yeah, there's a sound stab.
Yeah.
But that wasn't the problem. I think for you, you were saying, you know, I couldn't understand what was going on in the beginning because you're deaf in one ear. Well, I'm not deaf in one ear, and I couldn't understand what was going on at the beginning of the movie either. There was a sound mix issue going on, I think.
Hmm.
Oh, okay. So I was losing a lot of what the dialogue was telling us.
Well, also, let's be careful about, remember the theater had a couple issues that you just had to deal with while you were there. First of all, they had a lot of dealers up there in constant conversation, and the sound bled through the doors.
Yeah.
So there's constantly a rumble of extra level of sound in the theater. And the other thing is, in the front, they couldn't completely block off the lights that led to the so-called green room. So there's a constant level of extra light. Do you know what I mean? And then a lot of people kept coming in and out of the theater, opening the doors, and there's a lot of conversation going on at the main level.
Yeah.
That's just the way it was. You know, it's not like it was – it's just part of the convention scene.
Yeah, let's make it clear.
Yeah, this it was definitely not Cody's fault.
Yeah, this is a theater that was renovated from the 40s or maybe even earlier than that. And it's a gorgeous theater, but it feels
God,
very much
great, like an
Art Deco theater.
Yeah. And plus, we were in the balcony, which probably didn't help, but I see that as Kelly's fault. He told me that he and I were only allowed on the balcony. We couldn't go down and mix with the regular people. So.
Oh, did you stand up there?
So that's why.
What was
no,
that?
But when we actually the next day when we were waiting to see Kelly's film, I did have some popcorn and I threw popcorn at Matt Carpenter, who was sitting behind me and Kelly. So
that's right.
And I don't know if he noticed because he never said anything about it.
And I did originally say to Mike, "You want to sit in the back row and make out?" And he didn't say anything. Oh, but now I'm thinking maybe I said it in his bad ear.
Well, the answer would have been no.
Oh, well, all right.
I don't know if Matt's still on, but I threw popcorn at Matt. So it's a very immature thing to do, and I would do it again in a heartbeat.
So just because I spent the rest of the movie crying, it's fine.
So, yeah, it was a good time. If you're thinking of going to the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival, whether it's in California or Portland, you should definitely do it. You didn't interrupt me. Are you talking to me, Salome?
No, Joe.
Oh, it's okay. You can interrupt Joe. You can interrupt Matt. Just don't interrupt Callie or Joe. Pete. Yeah, you can't interrupt Kelly or Pete. That's the rule. You can interrupt everybody else. Okay.
Wait, what? You can't interrupt Kelly or Pete?
Right.
Is correct. That really the rule?
No, that is not the rule. You can interrupt me anytime you want.
Yes, Pete has a temper, and Kelly has a temper. Both of them, you know, they won't.
Pete doesn't have a
no,
temper.
No, yes, I am kidding.
Pete is a big sweetie.
I'm kidding. Yeah.
You have to watch out for Kelly. Yeah.
Tell me about it. He was my roommate at the film festival. We stayed at a nice hotel, me and Joe and Kelly and a bunch of guys. And so, Lehman, by the way, I want to say I'm really grateful for the chance. Sorry?
Joe, Kelly, and I.
I just want to thank you, sir. That ain't the right way to say that. Thanks for pointing that out. So, that just ain't right. So, first of all, I'm grateful for the chance to spend more time with Lehman. He's a really great guy. So, the first day, Friday, we were trying to find the guys, and Lehman and I were walking around. We had breakfast with Matt Carpenter, and then Lehman and I were walking around. I said, well, where's the other hotel? You want to walk over that and see if they're out? And he's like, yeah. He's like, is it? And I said something to the effect of, is it like the Crown Plaza? He goes, no, it's kind of murdery. We walked over there. Damned if it wasn't. It was, man.
Did you see a murder?
I thought, no, but it's the kind of place where it could happen. You could just tell that right away, even in the daylight.
I have to post pictures of that first night that I was there. I stayed with artist extraordinaire Nick the Hat Gucker, and our room, the AC unit was the power cord was electrical taped together. There was something that had been spliced and fixed on that with electrical tape. There was a big hole in the wall that had been covered with a piece of plywood that had been then painted a offset color to make it look like, you know, something, I guess, like a design choice. But that plywood had not been leveled to, you know, to look like it was there on purpose. It looked like it was hastily thrown up. And our bathroom door, the lock had been drilled out of. So at some point, somebody needed to be saved from some misadventure in the bathroom.
Okay. The place was the Banfield.
It was basically...
No, it was worse than the Banfield, man. I've stayed at the Banfield. It was way worse. It was way worse than the Banfield. And it was great. You can imagine being a destitute writer with an old typewriter and no money staying in this place, you know? Like, you know.
Yes. I'm not sure it was worse.
And avoiding the nightly murders, you know. You forgot to tell them about the Romanian cross that was laid across some kind of utility room on the first floor. Did you see that?
Yeah,
it was like they were trying to keep a vampire in there.
Right next to our room was a iron door with a cross hanging off of it. And Nick and I kept saying, you know, do not remove the cross. Under no circumstances should you remove this cross.
When I saw it, I said, are they trying to keep something in or something out?
Right.
You know, so.
So I'm gonna share a story with you, because I did not go to the film festival because I was at a conference.
With scientists.
No, yes, there was a science conference. So it took me, my room was 6 hours late. Check-in time was noon. They didn't get me my room until 6:30.
Wow.
Because the cheerleaders, there was a cheerleader convention in the hotel. And apparently the cheerleaders trashed the rooms. Which, you know, I'm calling bullshit. Okay? So to compensate for it, they give me a ticket so I can go eat a meal. They give me $50 credit to go eat the meal at the restaurant. Well, this is bullshit, because I can't eat more than $20, $30 worth of hotel food in one sitting, and I can't carry it over. They're not going to give me change. So it's bullshit, right?
Yeah.
Then I finally get to my room. I swear to God, there's blood splatter on the wall.
Oh my God. And a cheerleading outfit on the floor.
And in the closet, on the floor of the closet, was a little...
A dead cheerleader.
No! The paper with, like, cheer lyrics written out. Like, they were making up cheerleading lyrics in the hotel room. It was freaky, right? And then we have... So I was like, okay, you know what? I just won't look at the blood splatter. It's just, you know, trace anyway, but...
Good idea.
The next day, it starts to pour, and water just starts pouring out of the ceiling in the hotel.
I saw your post about your ceiling problems.
Pete, you should have gone to the film festival.
Yeah.
Did you let
Night of the Living Cheerleader.
About this blood?
Well, you know, it was a day's worth of rain. You know, it's Florida. It happens. You know, there's nothing, no big surprise.
No, I think Rick said you report the blood.
Who am I going to report the blood to? By the way, it took me 6 hours to get this room.
No, I would be worried about maybe, you know, something happened there and they got rid of the body, you know?
Yeah, it wouldn't be the first time I spent a night in a room like that.
Hey, you know, at that point, you're like, not my problem. You know, right?
So, Pete, next time you're going to a cheerleader con, just give me a call. I'll cancel my Lovecraft Film Festival.
I have a trivia question.
That you will.
Hold on. I'm not done.
You're not done yet.
Okay.
So then the next day after the storm, I'm at my conference, and we're sharing the space with the annual luncheon of the National Day of Prayer Committee.
Oh, good.
Who, in the middle of our luncheon, begin their hymnal. I thought this only happened to science fiction conventions.
Wow.
Honestly,
spread the good news?
Oh.
Yeah, did you go spread the news about the our Lord Cthulhu and tell him about the Cthulhu breakfast in California that they should be at?
Yeah, well.
And now they should invite Robert M. Price as his speaker.
It was the most bizarre week ever. I went to a bookstore and I wanted to buy a book, and this woman wouldn't get off the phone.
Yeah, I saw that Facebook post.
Like, she's talking about how busy she is, and like, I'm the only person in the store, and I can't check out! How busy could you possibly be?
Rick, did you have a cheerleader question?
Yeah, go ahead. No,
Why is San Pedro an appropriate site for a Lovecraft convention?
First of all, the theater.
Yeah, it's all because of the theater, Rick. They had that great, and it's really a great old theater from the 40s or 30s. It's gorgeous. You can't even describe how beautiful it is.
It's called the Warner Theater, and the Warner is named after one of the Warner brothers. It's an amazing theater.
I'm not asking why they chose it.
Rick, there's two other reasons you could say. One is, you're near a dockyard full of cranes and shipping containers, and you could make some kind of gritty noir type story take place amongst there involving deep ones and whatnot. But if you want to drive down the coast, just a little north of the festival, you're ending up with cliffs falling away from the highway into the ocean. Just gorgeous. Gorgeous wild scenery with waves crashing against the cliffs. So both of those scenes could be used to good effect by a Lovecraftian author.
Like Henry Kuttner.
Yeah, isn't this
San Pedro as a site?
Yeah, Black Kiss is set there, right?
And Hydra is set at least partially in San Pedro.
that theater, I took a picture of it and put it on the Lovecraft eZine Facebook page. I think it was on Friday. And one guy wrote, cool, that looks just like the kind of place you might walk into on a dark, rainy night to dry off, take in a flick, and wrestle with ancient horrors from the abyss. Which pretty much sums up that theater. It's pretty cool. So yeah. Okay. We got anything else we need to talk about before we sign off?
Well, I would like to say that I just finished Philip Fracassi's Altar, and man, I was blown away by that. I don't know if anybody else has bothered to pick that up, but it's disturbing as hell and really, really solid.
Who's the author?
Actually, Philip Fransaski, is that how you say his name?
Fracassi, I believe.
Let me spell it, because he supported the Kickstarter, too. Oh, Fracassi, yes, it's Fracassi. First name's Philip, with one L. Yeah, based on your recommendation, Kelly, the other day on Facebook, I looked for it on Kindle, and it's actually, if you have Kindle Unlimited, it's actually available on Kindle Unlimited.
Yeah.
I forget who the publisher is. I should know this.
Dynatalk Ministries.
Yeah, that was a Dynatalk one.
Which means
so it's available in print. Well, it'll last on Kindle.
Yeah. But, you know, sort of.
And Philip showed up at the Lovecraft Film Festival for one of the days, and it was one of those moments where here comes this guy I've never met before, and he's like, Kelly Young, as he's approaching me, and I immediately do the wrong thing, which is, who wants to know? And he says, Philip Fracassi, and I was hey, very nice to meet you. And I wish I had read the book just prior to meeting him so I could gush all over how much I loved it. Instead, I read it just after. And between him, Bartlett, Christy DeMeester, I feel like horror is in very good hands right now.
Yeah, Slatsky, We Hunt, yeah. that whole crowd are doing.
Is that a novella or is it a collection? I didn't get the cover
it's
yet.
It's just a tiny chapbook.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's one story, but boy, it sticks with you.
Yeah, he's a nice guy.
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. I'm sorry that I didn't get to meet him. I don't think I got to meet him at the film festival, but it's hard to meet everybody.
Yeah.
There's so many people there. All right, so again, it's Altar by Philip Fracassi. Yeah, Altar. Right. And it's available on Kindle and print from Dynatalks. And then, just as a reminder, I haven't read this yet, but it looks good. The Mammoth Book of Cthulhu, edited by Paula Grant, with a lot of big names in it. And
what a great cover. Man, I got to grab that.
It is, isn't it? That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's a great cover.
Since we're talking about Lovecraftian films, has anybody seen a 1981 movie called Possession with Isabel Adjani and Sam Neill?
Actually, Rick, I saw that just recently because you mentioned it.
I had not seen that one.
I haven't. Is it good?
Oh, it's very. It won an award for Best Actress at the Cannes Film Festival in 1981.
Wow.
You do have it mentioned on your site among Lovecraftian films.
Yes, I remember that because a reader recommended it, and I haven't seen it yet. And it was a solid enough recommendation that I included in the list.
Dead in Berlin, Ghost Town, and if you didn't know this was going to be Lovecraft, you think you're watching a psychological mystery, and then it takes this totally bizarre Lovecraftian twist.
But I'll have to watch it then.
It's quite an unusual. For anything, Isabella Gianni gives an incredible performance.
What did you think, Kelly?
I didn't love it. That ending was pleasant. If Rick hadn't recommended it to me, I think that if I had been watching it on my own, I probably would not have made it to the ending. But remind me again, Rick, who's the male lead?
Sam Neill,
yeah. And I love Sam Neill's films, and I love him as an actor. This is him pretty raw, very young, 1981. Overall, though, I it's one of those films. There are so many films that are saved by a solid third act, and this is one of them. I walked away thinking, well, that wasn't too bad. It wasn't until a couple days later thinking about it, that was not very good, but that third act made up for everything else.
Yeah, I mean, it is a little weird going into that because it totally changes direction in the third act.
Yeah, and it is really a psychological, not only in, you know, what we think of psychological, but what the 70s thought of psychological, which is a bunch of shit that just does not make sense to you in any possible way as a film watcher.
And the only thing, I've always said that Ava Green does the best acting of an insane woman.
Yeah.
Isabella Gianni can give a run for the money.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, Mike, since we're wrapping up, I'm going to show people. So I did get to a bookstore on the way home from my conference. And
did they help you?
Yes, because I got Hollow City, the second Miss Peregrine's, for $1.
Mm-hmm.
Bird Box.
I love that book so much.
$2.
I've not read that.
Kevin J. Anderson's Slim Underbelly, which is about a dead detective who's taking on Ah Cthulhu. So, you know, for $1, I'll pick it up.
Yep.
For $3.
Oh, wow. Look at that, Rick.
Yeah, it's just
crime. Yeah, explain what that is for the podcast listeners.
It's the pre-code crime stories, comic crime stories, you know, from before we had comics code, when you could do shit like kill people on in the page.
And have zombies.
So, and there's a lot of Steve Ditko early art in here. So, kind of happy with that. And this is the killer. They wanted $10 for this. Brain Movies, the original teleplays of Harlan Ellison, signed by Ellison and Straczynski.
That's for $10?
$10. And I'll tell you, I thought about it.
Wow.
Then I was like, wait, what are you thinking? Go, get it.
Yeah.
Because that was the expensive book in my pocket. So, but yeah, that was like...
Wow.
That was a good trip for me. I like that stuff.
Yeah, Mailerman's Bird Box was the best novel I had read that year. I think that was 2014.
Yeah.
Came out of nowhere. Excellent.
What kind of book is it? Is it a mystery? Is it a horror? Is it weird fiction?
It's horror. It is not weird fiction or Lovecraftian in any way.
Okay, so Mike... Mm-hmm. Remember the conversation we had by text while you were at the film festival?
Yeah, I do.
Something is out there. Something terrifying that must not be seen. One glimpse and a person is driven to deadly violence. No one knows what it is or where it came from. I picked this up 3 days after we had that conversation.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So that's Bird Box.
Bird Box.
Okay, I guess I gotta pick up Bird Box.
I've heard, like Kelly said, a lot of people say that this is a great book. And you know, for that price I'll pick it up.
The description sounds like cosmic horror. Are you saying it's not?
That's okay. I'll take a risk.
I suppose if you were to go very broad cosmic horror, It might fall into that, but it's not marketed that way, and I'm sure that he would not describe it as such.
Yeah, no, well, the premise sounds very interesting regardless. I mean, I read a lot of mysteries and many things that are not cosmic horror, let's put it that way.
Yeah, that was one that Nikki Gerlaine had recommended, and I picked it up, and I was just blown away.
I'll get it. Thanks for the recommendation, guys. Okay, so let's give away Fungi from Yawgoth. We've got two CDs to give away from Dennis Wheeler at Fadogan and Bremer, which is a publisher that you should check out, definitely. It's nice of Dennis to give these away because they're pretty cool. If you would like me to, if you'd like to be on the list for me to choose randomly next week, you can. If you're watching live, you can get in on this contest, and as usual, anytime between now and next Sunday, which is usually when I do the drawings, the following Sunday. If you're listening or watching, you can get in on the show and get in on the prizes. Sorry, just send an email to lovecrafteZinePrizes@gmail.com. Please put Fungi from Yawgoth in the title of the email, subject to the email, excuse me, and whatever you want in the body of the email, like something along the lines of "You guys are doing a fabulous job. Glad you added Kelly Young to the show." Whatever you want to say, you know. So
they won't want to say that, but okay.
Okay.
Absolutely. I'm fairly certain listenership has just dropped dramatically.
So is he like a permanent fixture now?
Oh yeah, he's.
When?
Wait! If that's how he answered, are you leaving after this?
What?
Are you going to be leaving if he is? I mean, we can.
No, I just want him to wear the cheerleading costume.
Good. Oh. What? No, we don't want that.
Am I the only one?
I think so. Joe, all right, like, so.
Cheerleading costume.
What's that? Apparently. Did you say something, Salome? Sorry.
I said Joe would like to see him in a cheerleading costume.
I couldn't hear that. I'm sorry.
I'll speak for Joe and say no, he would not.
I said you would like to see Kelly in a cheerleading costume.
Absolutely not.
Oh.
That's not what you said last weekend.
I'm already too aware of several of Kelly Young's deviant activities, and I don't want to see any more.
I would put my hands over my ears, but I have had.
And on that note, thanks everyone for watching and listening, and we will see everybody next week. And I forget. Oh, actually, I don't forget. It's our guest next week is Christopher Golden. So we'll see you then. Thanks for watching and listening.